Good afternoon, everyone. For all the parents who are watching this video, the last year that has gone by has been a difficult one for all of us, and specifically for parents, because we've had to make choices that we've never had to think about earlier. Simple things like, should we let our children step down in the evening to play? Should we cut our child's screen time since their eyes have already had enough screen while they were attending online classes? And now with the new academic year approaching, we yet have another big choice to make. Should we enroll our nursery-ready child in formal school at all, given the current situation this academic year? These choices are hard, and thus SchoolVisor has decided to get our parents some help. So for the discussion today, and for all the parents who are watching us, the next 30 minutes will be packed with questions such as, what the next academic session might look like for schools in 2021. Should the little ones be sent to school? If not, what's the alternative? And how does that compare to mainstream schooling? My name is Pooja Kedia from SchoolVisor. And today to help us with all these questions, I am joined by Mrs. Sayogita Sharma. She is a seasoned educationist with over 30 years of experience in school education. She comes with a master's degree in English and has a postgraduate diploma in school leadership and management. After a decade and a half with DAV Public School Faridabad, she joined Manav Rachna International School as a founder principal, and presently she is the director of Manav Rachna International Schools across NCR and Punjab. Thank you so much, Sayogita ji, for joining us today, and a very warm welcome to you.
Thank you, Pooja. Nice having me here.
I am also joined by Anuradha Handa. Mrs. Handa is currently the principal at GD Goenka Public School, Gurugram. Her career spans over two decades, and she has a postgraduate in physics and a professional degree in education. Prior to joining GD Goenka Public School, Mrs. Handa has been associated with schools such as Amity International, APJ School, and Modern Vasant Vihar. She firmly believes that each child is unique, and that is why the educational system should facilitate and address uniqueness of each child. Anuradhaji features in the web series Education Evangelist of India on the Forbes platform. Thank you so much for taking the time out and joining us today, Anuradhaji. Welcome.
Thank you, Pooja. Pleasure to be here.
We also have with us Mrs. Charumeni. Charuji has a career of 27 years in the field of education and is currently the principal at DAV Public School, Gurgaon. She believes education must bring together a fine synthesis between Vedic values and opportunities brought forward by modernist society. She is a double postgraduate in education and chemistry. Besides teaching and managing the school, she is an expert panelist and a resource person for teacher orientation workshops with CBSE and NCERT. Charuji is a keen grantist and a singer, and being trained as an NCC cadet, she takes challenges head on. A very warm welcome to you, Charuji, and thank you for being here today with us.
Thank you so much, Pooja, for such warm introduction. Thank you.
Right, so this year, I think because of the pandemic, we've all seen a lot of parents play the wait and watch game. They're not sure, and for a good reason, if it's a good idea to enroll their nursery-ready child in regular school. So for today's discussion, one of the things that I want to iron out first is to try and understand, for such parents, are there any alternate options? And do we able to do that? And Radhaji, I'd like to start with you. One of the key things that I'd want to do is try and wrap our heads around, what are the key differences as a parent that you should expect if you are putting your child in a mainstream K-12 school at nursery, vis-a-vis if you decide to homeschool them?
I'll try and address that, Pooja. So school is a social environment. School is a place where you have students, you have teachers, and you have a structure to the school. The child gets a very detailed exposure to not only teaching, learning, but a lot of other programs. You know, a three-year-old child, when he or she enters the school, there is bonding that happens between students. There is interaction that happens with teachers. And then the school has a structure to everything. So, you know, for us, when a child comes to us, we have typically about 15 activities that the child goes through every week. Now, it is those experiences in school that builds a child's personality, confidence, and lays the foundation for the school life. So I feel that definitely parents are, you know, the first gurus of the child. But there is a greater role that the gurus and the environment at school plays, which I feel is absolutely essential for a child to be in as far as the formal schooling is concerned, because there we also have experts, the teachers who are experts of early years and of education. So to say that a formal school at pre-primary and the first 4 years lay the foundation for school life.
Great. I think very well said. And the key words that stuck out for me there was social environment, which unfortunately we will not be able to provide the child at home. The structure that the school has, again, is something that I think parents will struggle with. And you'll have to be very harsh on the child to be able to put that structure day in and day out on your child. Building personalities and making sure that your child is in the hands of experts. And I think that's beautiful, beautifully summed up. Having said that, I just want to ask a follow-up question on that. While all that is good, but given the current scenario where the child is actually doing online classes from home, does that difference between homeschooling and sending the child to a formal school now narrow?
So is that meant for me, Pooja?
Yes, Anuradha.
See, we have had a year where definitely while the children were being schooled at home, but it wasn't homeschooling, you know, because when you have, you literally had teachers reaching out to children at home, and that is the difference. So there is schooling happening, but there is a structure, there is a timing, there are multiple interactions that a child has with the teacher, with the peers. And in fact, you know, over a period of time, we realized that it is not only those formal interactions that are required. We created provision where we just had a group of children coming together and the teacher was merely present there and facilitated the children talking to each other. You know, those social interactions and peer relationships that the children were missing out on. So we facilitated that. And in fact, we could engage them in a lot of experiential learning at home. You know, a simple project like from farm to table, the bread. So we made use of the fact that since the children are at home, so they could engage themselves along with their parents in real time, cooking without fire at home. So definitely the gap in terms of homeschooling and the way schooling happened at home has reduced, but the structure and the format that it has, that only was possible because we still had those experts reaching out to children. We still had a structure of program that was being conducted. We still had, you know, the essence of those interactions that are so essential. So there is absolutely no replacement for that.
Great. Thank you so much. So for all the parents who've heard that, there, the formal schooling comes out as a clear winner. And for reasons like the structure, the expert who takes on and makes sure the class is facilitated in the right direction, the social engagement and the entire personality development. Great. Now let's just hop on to the next part of the alternate that a parent has. And this question I'm going to direct towards you, Sanyogita ji. The other option that parents are looking at very actively today is that bacha play school mein ja raha hai. Let's not touch the child, let them continue for another year, and then we'll figure out what needs to be done for their formal schooling next year. So there are a lot of parents who are sitting in that bracket as well. What is your advice to them firstly, and in your opinion, does it really matter if a child does their nursery from a play school vis-a-vis a formal K-12 school? What's your opinion on that?
See, Pooja, before we start this, I will definitely like to put across what Anuradha ji said, just add one or two points more to that. Schools have professionals, learning environment that is created by schools, the learning experiences that the school professionals create in a social environment, which is school, which has a structure. That is why schools are very, very important. And coming to your question, I'll say that play school or K-12 schools. So I will see the school structure. So what kind of philosophy the school has? So when you talk about early years, we all understand that this is a very important phase of a child's life. 85 to 90% of his development happens during this time when we call it the foundation stage. So that means all his foundation for thinking, for behavior, for life skills, for lifelong learning are set in this period. So we definitely need to choose a school where you find this thought reflected into the classrooms, reaching to the teachers, right? Because the child every day going to a school has an interaction with the teacher. Right? So we need to look at that. What is the philosophy of a school that you are sending your child to? What is it from this age group we mean by schooling? It is not direct instruction to be imparted to these children. It's not that they're going to schools for reading and writing. It's all about learning atmosphere, the learning environment, and the thought that goes behind, though it's a flexible and informal way of learning, but still there's a thought behind that. There's an objective behind that. There are learning outcomes aimed at, you know, that.
So, right. But so Yogaraji, if I could interrupt you here, from a layman parent's perspective, typically parents don't really know till their child finally lands up in school what to expect from that nursery grade. Now, a lot of parents are in that comfort zone that the child is going, or well, not going right now, but is doing virtual classes in the play school. It doesn't really make sense to put the child in front of suddenly, in front of a computer with new faces. So let the child carry on. I hear you said that, you know, it doesn't really matter as long as the ethos of the school agrees with the parent and there is structured learning approach. But as an educationist, because you know really what happens in the background, do you think there is difference in the structure, the content, the kind of teachers that typically take nursery classes in a play school vis-a-vis a formal school?
Definitely, I will say there's a lot of difference, because when you're going for a K-12 schools, there's a complete spectrum. So you have a complete direction and you completely look at, for the new education policy has now come out with this plan 3+3+, you know. So you clearly understand where you are taking your child to, what is to be done in which bracket. You're phasing it out properly. You're laying the stress where, I won't say stress, but you're weaving in into the complete tapestry of your school. So that I think gives more purpose and meaning, right? And the professionals and the complete, you know, philosophy of education, because education is not only restricted in fragments, you know, it's a complete spectrum, right? So if the leadership of a K-12 school can see it completely in a wholesome way, comprehensively, I think it is a more balanced and more holistic atmosphere that the children get in here. Because at times the parents feel chota hai, the child will feel safe, secure. But we need the, you know, greater objective that we are trying to achieve through these 3 years of preschooling, which are so vital and have a big time impact on the child. So even if he's in a play, he can look forward to.
Great. Thank you so much. And that's beautifully explained. And I know that there are so many parents who come to us and who tell us that, you know, he's just little, like you said, chota hai, aisa kya kar lega, ABC aur 1-2-3 to padna hai. Now, my advice to all those parents, we've just heard, you know, two of our experts talk about the fact that it's not just the fact that they're going to be doing simple things, but these simple things actually lay a foundation for what the child will learn in the future. So absolutely, you know, as long as you're comfortable with the ethos of the school, as long as you're comfortable with the structure that is being provided, it's all right to put your child in play school, but a formal environment based on what Sanyogataji has just said is preferred. Charuji, I'm going to spin the same question in a slightly different way for you. Now, there are parents who have clearly said that either because of financial reasons or because they're really paranoid given the current pandemic situation, they have decided they are going to keep their child at home. Now, these parents are essentially thinking the child is going to stay at home and they will start their child's formal school journey in KG. Do you think that's a good idea? What's your opinion?
I would take from what Anuradha ji and Sanyogita ji have said. It is really very important that the child is put into a structured K-12 school, okay? And even though if you are picking up a play school, as you had said, for the play school also, if the play school has that philosophy, the teacher there, knows what NEP talks about, the foundation literacy and numeracy, because that is very important. And very rightly said, the first 5 years are very important in the child's life. These first 5 years would actually make up how the next 80 or 85 years of the child go by, okay? Because the brain and neural developments all take place in this time. And at school, because we are taking care of whether the child is listening ready, reading ready, writing ready, and number concepts, pre-number concepts, everything has to be taken care of. So all these things are like the trained ECCE, the early childhood care educationists, they are trained in that. It's not that you just pick up any Google sheet or a video from the Google, YouTube and just play for the child and the child just dances and all. It's not like that. Everything is structured. The cognitive, sensory, language, social, emotional, physical, all these skills are to be taken care of. The psychomotor skills, the gross motor skills, and the fine motor skills are to be taken care of.
And yeah, that's a very valid point that you put through. If I were to spin that question a little bit more, now we've also heard parents, you know, who come to our portal and they've said, well, you know, we're happy with sending our child to school, but we're not happy with the child who goes to nursery to attend online classes, you know, after having attended online classes in the play school environment. The teachers known, the other fellow children are known. So that's a comfortable haven for the child. Now to suddenly shift and uproot the child and put them in front of new faces on a screen is not something that a parent is comfortable with. For such parents, if they were to decide, you know, let's hope that, you know, schools open maybe after the summer break sometime later this year. If that were to happen, in your opinion, how easy or difficult would that transition be for the child to then start physical schooling after having not done structured learning for, let's say, 5-6 months in their nursery?
So for these type of parents, my advice is that they have to experience that how different it is. And in fact, for my school, that there are certain parents whose elder kids have studied in the school in nursery KG and now they are in class 4-5 maybe. And now the younger one is there. And they said, we never knew that so much goes into nursery KG. We thought that the child is just coming. And so it's the kind of activities and that are done with them is important. And even when the child is there in front of the digital mode, and then when the physical shift is there, it would be easy because the child knows now that how my teacher looks and my peers, because we are, though it is digital, we are giving enough peer interactions. There are Saturday buddy classes and then happy me classes where the children are interacting with each other, and these little ones are given opportunities to like ma'am was saying, cook without fire and, sure, and display, talk to each other. All these things really matter a lot. That's
thank
it.
You,
and milestones, so timelines. One thing I would like to add here, one very important thing is that identification of learning gaps. Many a times the parent doesn't come to know about the learning gaps, the milestone that the child has to reach at this particular age. And like for our school, without naming the children, obviously, we do get children with special needs. And many a time a parent doesn't want to bring this to open and that my child has a speech impairment or a mild autism maybe. And we have experienced this, that if early detection of all these is taken and the things are really cared for and the child becomes totally all right. We have had such cases and I'm really proud of those students who have come out of the impairment, slight impairments that they had.
Perfect. I think going back to what everybody has echoed here. So what you're saying is also, you know, put your child in the hand of experts because they will be able to identify if there's any gap that needs correction. And also, you know, you've said that overall, you also echo what Anuradha ji and Sanyogita ji have voiced. Great. Thank you so much. Anuradhaji, I'm going to move on to you with my next question. In your opinion, for parents who are going to be first-time visual classes parents, what are the kind of challenges, in your opinion, that they are bound to face, both they and their children, and how are schools equipped to help these parents?
So we are talking of the parents and the children who are going to be coming for the first time for the online classes. Yes. And this we are talking of into a formal school in nursery, yes. Right? They may yes. or may not have had the experience of a play school, and it may be the first time for them.
Yeah.
So in both the cases, in fact, if I can just make a little point on the fact that why we have to have, you know, in nursery, a formal school to be attended, you were talking about that point of a comfort. So there is one point that I want to make here that, you know, it is always a sapling which is planted. If you allow a sapling to grow into a plant and then you have to uproot it and place it at another point, I feel there is greater difficulty and there is a greater chance of it may not bloom the way it can when it is a sapling. So that 3 years of age to put a sapling into a school to bloom into a tree is important, is required, because children should make connections. See, a school carries a 14-year vision. We are very clear with the milestones and the, you know, the needs of the children at every stage. So when we are making a plan, a pedagogical plan, and the pursuits of the school, we are keeping in mind every type of development that the child should undergo at that appropriate age. And the number of experts and the programs and the vision that a formal school carries is what a child requires at the age of 3. Now, with regard to the kind of preparation that a parent needs to have for a child who's entering into school on a virtual mode, you know, I think we, it is only initially, like in our school, a nursery child within the first 2-3 months became independent, because our entire focus was that we gradually allow the child to be actively attending classes. You know, today, if you look at our children, all of them, they are on their own logging into the system. They are independent. They are expressive. In fact, a lot of aspects of their personality and skills have got developed more than that what would have happened in a physical environment. A lot of listening skill has developed. You know, we do this program where we ask them to switch off their camera and respond to what the teacher is talking, maybe draw, maybe, you know, react and act. And we've seen that their skills have developed. Communication skills, listening skills, responses, responsibility as we more, you know. So for the parents who are going to be enrolling their children into nursery for the first time, the school will orient the parents as per the requirement, that the expectation that the school has from the parent and from the child. You don't have to worry. And you will find, to your amazement, parents, that the children will sooner than later become independent, adapt, and adjust. And we are definitely hopeful, and we are looking forward to, if not completely offline classes, very soon a hybrid model, you know, and the school is ready for that. And especially the flipped classes, you know, the children being able to go through the asynchronous material that the school shares, the plan for the next day that the school shares, so that preparation is done in, you know, in collaboration with the parent and the child, so that the real joy of learning is what is focused on while the classes are going on. Great. So no real preparation, keep an open mind, believe in the system, come in, you know, just allow the child to be with the teacher and the school, believe in school programs, and it is going to be a smooth sailing for you.
Awesome. For all the parents, that's a lot of positivity for you to take in. So I think I personally, I love the example that you gave for the sapling. And I think I agree to a great extent with you as a mother who has children herself. I think independence is the right word that you've used, because children have gotten a lot more independent. So yes, for first time parents, it is going to be slightly overwhelming, because your child has probably never sat in front of a laptop, and you'll be worried that the laptop is going to land up in two pieces by the time the first lesson finishes. But hopefully the teachers there at the other end will be able to handhold the child and make sure that they put them at a point where they become more responsible, more independent. So just let your child go out there in open waters and swim, and hopefully they will come out as swimmers. Thank you so much for that. I know you mentioned something, you know, there about the parents' involvement and orienting the parent. And Sanyogita ji, I'd like to come with to you with my next question, which is linked to that. A lot of parents also come with us and tell us, well, I can't put my child this year in nursery. And when we ask them why, they say, well, because me and my husband are working. And we say, okay, and why does that stop you? They're like, well, because obviously the child is three, a parent will need to sit with the child through their classes. We can't afford that. What is your thought in that? Is online virtual classes that will happen now for the next academic year or that are happening now, specifically in the first few months, is it only for families where there is one parent to assist the child?
See, Pooja, first of all, I must say that we are very much hopeful that the children will come to school. And I'm hopeful because we have a school in Noida, and some of the parents walked into the school and they said that my child is not happy taking his online classes. We want our children to come to school. So there were 10 of them. So 10 nursery class children, just a month back, they were dropped into the schools and they attended the school 2 hours, and it was difficult for the parents to take them back home.
Oh, wow. Okay.
So that 10 multiplied into 20. So that is what I can say, that all parents want their children to go back to school. They are looking forward to it, that the schools open. Everybody, we and the parents, the community wants that the schools need to be open, because a lot of educational advancement will come in if we bring it. All said and done, we talk about homeschooling or learning on screen something. But the educational advancement definitely gets put behind, right? So what you're saying is that the parents, when they think about that, we don't want to send our children to school. So it definitely, when they are very little children, some adult has to be a part of it, right? So not only with the little ones, even when we say our children have become very responsible using gadgets and devices, they're using it into the drills. They have become very, very expert. But when it comes to learning on devices, it is first time experience for them as well. So taking responsibility for learning and responsibly using that for the learning sake, they are yet learning. Because we find in senior classes, they log in and they are not there, right? They are using some other means of sending their assignments there. So that means when it comes to learning online, they also are yet to get into that mode, that this is a responsible way of learning and they need to learn that. So what you're saying is absolutely right. The child definitely, but the parents can make some arrangements, but it will be very good if the schools open, they send, but they should not stop their child's learning for one complete year, because this is a very, very important year in the child's life. Once gone, I think we know the after effects of COVID, but we still do not know the impact on children's life if they miss out on one complete year of their learning.
Absolutely,
right? Because this is going to affect. So we need to make some sacrifices here and there, make some arrangements, but make sure that your children, if they're age appropriate, they should go to school.
Great. So again, you know, the key takeaway for me there was make sure that the learning doesn't stop. Make sure you make some alternate arrangements. Don't just close that door. Try and look for solutions. And there will be some sacrifices that will need to be made on the way, but that is life. Chaluji, if I could come to you with my next question, again related to that. The other worry that parents have is that they think, well, let's say, assume schools open sometime in April, June, July, they shut for summer vacation, and we're all hopeful that schools would open later in the year for physical classes. In an event, what that typically means is for a child who's not been attending school so far, the parent might have to invest in a gadget or a laptop for an interim period of 4 to 6 months. What is your advice to such parents? Is that investment worth it, or is there an alternative that they can look at?
Thank you, Pooja ji, for this question. First thing is that for the parents who are both of them, if they both of them are working, I would just like to pitch in for this also, that we send them videos to them so that they, once they are home, they can work with the children. The activities are performed by the teacher, and various material that's there at the home itself, the parents create those activity material and the students perform. So it is a guided learning with the parents at the time when the parent is comfortable with. So we have been even in this digital mode, this virtual mode has brought one thing very close to us is that we are more flexible. If the parent says, okay, keep my, because otherwise also we do not keep 20 students in one virtual class because then it does not go proper. Okay, so we have very small classes of 10. So the teacher takes the same lesson twice or thrice, and then the parent gets adjusted to the time that's given to them. So that is one thing. And sending them modules, as ma'am and Radha ma'am said, flipped learning modules. So to the parents, that also helps them. And learning must not stop. Now coming to the laptop and gadgets. See, a simple smartphone is there with everyone. Okay, so they can the classes can be held can be taken on these smartphones. Then in our schools and in all most of our schools that we have here, we have those laptops in the English lab and the ATL labs. So we did provide those laptops also to the students, if obviously with an undertaking that they have to take care if that was the need. And yes, and the school is open for the higher classes. If there is a need, the child can come to school. We are, till now, we are not doing anything of this kind because they have to be in a bubble. And the children are carriers of the virus. They do. They are not getting affected by the virus. They are not catching it, but they can be asymptomatic carriers for the adults at home. So we have to take care of that, that the bubble should not break.
Right. So great. That, thank you so much. And that's absolutely fabulous to know. I wasn't really aware that schools are giving out that option. And if that is there, that's absolutely fantastic. So for all the parents, you know, if that is an option that your school might be offering, please do get in touch with them. For senior students anyway, you know, schools have opened. The other thing that just came to my mind when you mentioned that is why just school, go around, try and see if you can borrow a laptop for the interim through friends, or you get even rental laptops that you can, you know, go ahead and try and lay in your hands on. Great. That brings us to pretty much the end of a very, very interesting discussion. But before we go, really quickly, in 30 seconds, if I could come to each one of you and check with you, if there was one piece of advice that you'd want to give to all these parents who are holding back, who are apprehensive, who are scared, and are not really sure what to do, what would that piece of advice be? Charuji, since we were talking to you, let me start with you.
Okay. So if you fall ill, Google is all full of the advices. If zukam, if there is some runny nose, what do you do and all those things. What do you do? But do you do only that? You do go to the doctor, isn't it? So the teachers there out there are all trained in their ECCE. So have faith, because if you, and please put your child in the school, in the formal schooling, and see how beautifully the child, your sapling blooms. That's one.
Great. Thank you so much. Aniradhaji, if I could get your thoughts as well.
All right. So I think I would lay emphasis on the fact that we know that in the first 5 years of a child's life, maximum brain development happens. All the neuron connections that are made. So in those 5 years, 3 years are gone at home. So out of the remaining two, if the child sits at home for one more year, you are actually missing out on 50% of the total time available to make those connections in the entire life, on which the foundation of the remaining years is laid. So I think one has to be wise to take a decision and not compromise, because it means a lot to the life and development of the child.
Thank you so much. Sanyukta ji, your words, please.
I will say that schools are happy places. They're very important for the well-being of children. They're social, they're psychological, they're mental well-being, their cognitive well-being. So they need to come to school. They come to school only not for academics. They are coming here to make friends, to have relationships, to feel good about the things. So their body, their mind will be healthy, sound, and will be setting that foundation for a healthy life for them. So for happiness, for joyful learning, come to school.
Great. Thank you so much. So I hear everyone say, have faith, critical years. So make sure your child goes to school and it's a happy place. So please do send your child to a happy place. It has been an absolutely amazing discussion. I hope the parents have had some more faith after talking to educators who are extremely positive and extremely promising. Thank you so much for your time, Charuji and Radhaji and Sanyoguta ji. It's been lovely talking to all three of you.
Thank you so much, Pooja.
Thank you.